by using the steps just here, I can show you how to do that in a way that's reasonably secure. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to decide first of all where we want to send the funds to. So I created a new wallet on the ledger, Horizen 2, and the reason why I do that is that you will find that if you have, say, an account on your ledger that has, you know, hundreds and thousands of transactions in there that are like all dust transactions, it will lag ledger live terribly. It'll just sit there synchronizing for ages. The whole thing will be terribly slow even after you've moved money out of it. So look, if you're wanting to like transact regularly with the account that you're mining into, that might cause you issues. Or if you want everything to be fast, you might just want to create a new account on your ledger. So you just say add accounts and move it all into that. So what we're going to do is we want to move it all to that account that was Horizen 2, which if you recall before was this is its address. So we'll just copy that and stick it there for now. So that's where it's going to go. So this scenario is one where you simply would stop using the original one that was full of dust and full of lag. So we decide we want to move the funds. Second step is retrieve your 24-word recovery phrase. So hopefully you have it written down on paper somewhere. I really hope you don't just have it sitting in Notepad like this example one here, because again, that 24-word key, if someone has that, they can get the lot. So retrieve your 24-word recovery phrase. Now what you're going to want to do here is create an air-gapped PC environment, because before you just go punching this 24-word key into a computer, you want to make sure that computer is offline, so it's not connected to the internet, so that, you know, some malware or whatever on there isn't just going to send your 24-word key immediately to some one who's dodgy, who's going to steal all your coins. You also want to not just, you know, unplug your computer from the internet to do this, just because you know, you never can quite be sure that the environment you're running on your PC is entirely clean. So the best way to avoid that is to create sort of an air-gapped PC environment. The easiest way to do that is just to download sort of like a live CD. And Tails Linux is a good example of something like that. So that's basically just a distribution of Linux that you can download. You could download a live CD of like Ubuntu or any other Linux distribution like that, where you basically download it, copy it onto a USB, you know, following their instructions, and then boot that in either, say, an old computer you might have lying around, maybe an old laptop, or any other device. But, you know, make sure you unplug its physical network cable when you do that, and don't just immediately connect it to your Wi-Fi as soon as it's booted into this Linux environment, because all you really need for this process is a clean environment, again, like a completely fresh live CD install of something that has a web browser in it. That's all you need. So yeah, Tails is a good one to use, or if you're familiar with Ubuntu, again, just download a Ubuntu live CD, you know, boot into that, and you can use it as your air-gapped PC environment. I'm not going to go over how to do that, just because there's plenty of demos that say how to do it. Before you sort of shut down out of your main Windows in, or whatever environment you're using as well, you want to download a converter that can let you convert your 24-word recovery seed into a whole bunch of private keys. And there's this Ian Coleman one, which is great, and again, I'm accessing it in my browser right now, but if you go to the website, scroll down to the bottom of the page, you can actually just go to his GitHub, and it tells you how to use it offline. So you can actually just go there, go to the releases page, and you basically download, you know, one HTML file, and that does everything it needs to do. So that HTML file will sit on your air-gapped PC. So basically, you open it up just on your air-gapped PC, just like this. So you'd save that onto a USB stick along with your live CD, basically. So that what happens is you boot into your air-gapped environment, you open up this Monic code converter in the browser. and that's what you're going to do. The other thing you're going to want to do before you, I guess, I'm sort of assuming here in these instructions you're going to be using the same PC and sort of having to reboot away from your normal desktop environment. But we also just want to make sure you know the public address to contain the coins that you want. So in this example, you know, we needed to know that that 0.1 Zen that we have available in Ledger Live here corresponds to this. So you can see where it's to. Corresponds to this address right here. So it's important to know that because you need to know which public key you want to get. Because each address has one public key and one private key, and you need to get the right one because they will only work with the right one. So you need to note that down. So I'll just for the sake of clarity, say in this case that was this address here. So you then stop. So you wouldn't have typed in your 24-word recovery key anywhere here on your internet connected computer. You would shut down your computer, load up into your air-gapped environment, and you'd be here. So we could assume that this is your air-gapped thing. See, it's running the standalone mnemonic code converter. You would then type your 24-word recovery seed in rather than copying and pasting it, because you shouldn't have it even on a USB just sitting in a file. So you type in there, you'd load up, select the coin you want, Zencash. And again, this will work for basically any Bitcoin fork. So you know, if you're mining Vertcoin using P2 pool and have tons of dust, you often can get the same issue. And then we can see the public key. So we would then copy the private key or write it down with a pen and paper if you want. That's another option. You can just write it down, or you could just save it in a text file on the USB with your live CD, and then you can sort of shut down and turn off your air-gapped environment once you have that private key, because you don't want it, you don't need any of the other private keys, and you don't want to sort of connect this thing to the internet until you've shut it down and it's all been cleaned. So then you've got your private key from your air-gapped environment. You would jump to My Zen Wallet. And again, My Zen Wallet is something that just runs in your browser. You can actually just download it directly from the Zencash official GitHub. Again, it's just something that runs in a browser. The other option you do have is you can use the Swing Wallet. So if you go to the Zen Wallet's website and download the official full client, you can import single private keys into it. However, you need to understand that the entire blockchain will have to sync before you can send your funds. So what you'd do if you downloaded the Swing Wallet would be to download it, let the full blockchain sync, and only when that has happened would you import your private key and then send your funds basically straight away. But frankly, the browser-based one works very well, and you don't need to sync the whole chain either. But if you are all about privacy and stuff, then the Swing Wallet will give you a better result in that regard. So again, starting from scratch, if you'd have your private key that you've written down on a piece of paper, but we're cheating just because it's just a demo, you would then go to this online web wallet or the one that you've downloaded, sort of the downloaded version of it, but it'll all look the same. Click settings, paste private key, then unlock it, and there's the fun. So you'd grab them, whoops, send them from there, say yes, we want to send them to here. So that was the address we had earlier. We'll want to send a lot, just all in one go. Yes, I'd like to send these Zen, and send. Oh yes, not enough. Hang on a minute. Sorry, I didn't have 0.1, I had 0.01. Yep, there we go. So you just type it, stick in the amount so we can see the 0.1. You will have to do your own manual fee calculation, I think. But let's just try it without it. Send. There we go, successfully sent. So if we jump into Ledger, we will actually in a sec see that appearing. But we can, it's on the blockchain now, so we can just click there. 0.1. Oh, there we go. So now it's appeared. So we can see, even though I didn't send that in Ledger, even though my Ledger Nano is not even connected, we can see that the 0.1 Zen has left the account, and we can see it's arrived here in Horizen 2. So what we could do then, if that had nothing in it anymore and we were certain we're not mining to there, and we don't want this to lag, we could just remove that account altogether. Just delete, basically, or you could just leave it there. So it's up to you how you want to do it. So even simply just moving the funds into the next available address on your existing Horizen account will generally fix all the unspent outputs as well. But again, how that all performs will depend very much on the client that you're using, and my experience with Ledger in that space has not been great, and that's half the reason why they tell you not to mine straight to your ledger. But anyway, it doesn't, you don't lose your funds or anything like that. It's just can sometimes mean a few extra steps to get back, and Ledger don't like it again because it loads their servers down when you've got all these unconfirmed transactions that their client then has to go back and check. So yeah, there you go. So that's how you do it, and yeah, it's pretty straightforward. The other thing, though, that I should again emphasize is once you have done this, once you have exported a private key from your hardware wallet and sort of imported it into a software wallet or a web wallet or any other internet-connected thing, you should consider that that address is now compromised, or at least only as secure as some other software wallet. So it's no longer protected in the same way that all your other hardware wallet stuff would be. So if you found this useful, please hit like on the video, or like the channel even, or send us a tip in whatever cryptocurrency you use. And yeah, if you've got any questions, feel free to post them in the comments. More than happy to help you out. It's pretty straightforward, and once you get your head around how it works, it can all make a lot more sense, and you can be a lot more confident in how you're going to do all of this.